Hi, everybody. Welcome to another session of Offstage. I'm Teddy Bart. It's a rare gift when an entertainer has the ability to look at life and look at people and create a character that all of us can relate to and see a bit of ourselves in many, many different people and make us laugh while doing it, and sometimes make us shed a tear while doing it. And that indeed is the gift possessed by a fantastic actress, comedian, Miss Lily Tomlin, and she's our guest.
Thank you.
Is that okay, that kind of introduction for you?
Yeah, that's exactly what I like. I mean, when you said I see a bit of ourselves in the character, and you know, some people think that I'm a very scathing satirist.
Yes.
You know, and they don't always see how affectionately I feel toward all those characters.
Yeah, I can see that, though, that when you're doing the telephone operator or the conservative sorority student, you know, what you're really doing is giving a little affection to those kinds of people who in themselves may have some problems.
They don't have any problems.
No?
No, I mean, they don't have any problems more than anybody else does. You know, I mean, it's just really trying to take a type out of the culture and just sort of compress it and essence it down, you know, so that you can feed it back. But I don't see them as having any particular kinds of problems, you know, other than just being human and living in the world.
Well, I mean the conservative student, what's her name?
Susie Sorority.
Susie Sorority. I mean, hasn't her time passed and she knows it, and she's, you know, in a way trying to just say, I understand this world?
No.
No?
I think she still speaks for a certain segment of people, you know, who cling to old rigid values. No, who just cling to, you know, a certain kind of... what she perceives as a kind of decency and order. You know, you may not agree with her, but... there are a lot of people who have a similar view, I think.
Okay, now, when you see Susie, for instance, I mean, were you walking one day on a college campus, or were you, when you were in college, did you know a type like that, or is she just conjured up out of your head?
Well, let's see. How does it come about? Susie came, I was conscious of how many people did, you know, used okay in their speech.
Mm-hmm.
Susie goes back a long time, you
okay.
know, to the early, like 1971. And, you know, everybody would, and people who would always say, I want to tell you about something, and first of all, when we're going to go to the store, I want you to know that I'm not going with you. Okay. And besides that, I want, you know, it was this repetition of okay, okay, okay.
Uh-huh.
And I liked that. I thought that was, and I hadn't seen anybody utilize that as to communicate a culture type. And then in that throwing of the head, you know, that, okay, okay. And it just... I don't know, it just comes, you know, it starts to live in my body. So I do Susie, and I just see her, she's just very earnest, and that's just how she is, and she just wants to be that way. And I just do it, you know.
Yeah, do you...
I practice it until it just sort of happens. Like when I started to do Ernestine, the material was conceived, you know, I would improvise harassing people and intimidating them. And then I began to realize, unconsciously, see, my body drew into itself. You know, it was so sexually repressed to wield this petty power and to threaten people that unconsciously I would be like practicing and trying to create something and not knowing where I was going to go with it. And all of a sudden, I saw it just turned in on me like that. And so, of course, when she snorted, the snort was natural, too. And
what's going to happen to Ernestine?
I'm very worried.
Are
because
you?
Of the monopoly?
Yes.
Breaking up the monopoly? I don't know. I really don't, because...
Do you think she can be replaced by an Ernestine computer or something?
Well, it's not her being replaced so much as she may walk away.
Just from it all?
Because I don't think she wants to work for a company that is not omnipotent.
Oh, I see. I see.
Power is very important to her. And to have to start sharing it with people or to have it fragmented, you know, it doesn't sit well with her.
Be the end of it, so she might just go home someplace. And...
I don't know. I know she's been doing a lot of soul searching about it. Yeah.
And every time she sees a phone, she gets a little teary-eyed.
I started to say she gets, I started to say something else. suppose. Do you edit?
No.
Oh. Good thing I didn't say it.
Yeah.
And when she sees a phone now, I suppose if she sees a Bell instrument, you know, I mean an instrument that Bell distributed, yes, but if she sees one of those other instruments, she probably, you know, would like to take an axe to it.
I understand. Let me ask you something else right now. I got the picture.
All right.
How young were you when you started fantasizing that you could create other people, that you could create characters?
I don't know that I'm not even conscious of it. You know, I watched my parents and my aunts and my uncles, who were all Southerners and came from Kentucky, and I used to get tremendous enjoyment out of just watching everybody interrelate and you know, old attitudes and the way people talk to one another and they characterize a trait in one person in relationship to another one. Oh, you're just as fussy as Odie May, you know, and you get a little essence of something. And then I grew up in an old apartment house in Detroit that was filled with people. And, I mean, every possible type, you know, very political people, very apolitical, educated, uneducated, all races, different. And everybody had something that, similar to somebody else, really. And yet they were so distinctive and... I mean, I've said this before, that's why I try not to repeat myself so much, but I saw more similarities in the people than I saw differences, you mm-hmm. know? And,
Were they mostly blacks in the apartment that you were
no,
in?
No, my building was this last little bastion of white hood.
In Detroit?
Is that what you mean? Yeah. But
yeah.
We lived in a black neighborhood. But this little old, this real tacky old apartment house, you know, these people still clinging to it as if it was like some very, you know, dignified, very special place, you know, that only white people should live in.
Mm. We're gonna take a break, Lily, and then we'll talk more about what makes you tick.
Right.
Lily Tomlin's with us. Stay with us. We'll be back. Is it hard for you to talk about yourself?
I don't think so. Why don't you try me?
Well, the reason why I ask you that is because a lot of comics, I have found that the funny stuff is a surface to protect something beneath, and when you try to ask them questions about themselves and their feelings and what hurts them and this sort of thing, they'll go into a routine
uh-huh.
pretty quick, or another character. And I wonder whether that kind of penetration of personality gives you any problems.
No, I don't think so. I mean, I would be very circumspect about what I would share. I mean, I'm not the kind of person to go on the media and just be kind of crudely open, you know, I mean, just lay a whole bunch of stuff out. I just think it's in poor taste, you know?
Is it?
I mean, it's one thing to talk about your feelings and certain philosophies and things like that, but I would, you know, I would be more discreet than to... talk about my private life to any, like, intense degree. I've seen people come on, you know, and divorce their spouses on television.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or silly, crazy things like that.
And they talk about very intimate parts of their
yeah,
life.
Yeah, right. But, you know, I mean, I have more sense of decorum than that. It doesn't appeal to me. I feel it depends on the tone, I suppose, or the kind of real... you know, sensibility with which it's communicated too, because I do think it's important for people to share their feelings and to let other people in the world know about common experiences. You know, that people perhaps aren't aware that other people share, particularly maybe famous people or very, very successful people. I think it's as difficult and as painful as I think it must be, I think it's rather courageous when people do tell the world that their child has a drug problem, or that you know, they've had an alcoholism problem. In a way, you know, just to take the stigma, these things have to be shared in the world.
Well, it alleviates, it lessens part of the problem that the ordinary folks out there who have the same child who has the same problem, and when they see someone famous has it, why?
Yeah.
I guess it lightens the burden just a little bit.
Yeah.
What about the the gossipy type of reporter and questions and tabloid that you see. I mean, do you read that stuff?
Well, I get some of my best material. I was standing in a supermarket one day, and there was a kind of a test person. I do a bag woman. She wasn't a real bag woman, but she was sort of a test person. And she was reading Rona Barrett's Hollywood, you know. And I didn't even think she knew who I was. And I was just waiting on line behind her and waiting on line. And she turned to me and she said, "Boy, Rona can't find out nothing on you, can she?" You know. And sure, I read them once in a while. They're amusing, you know.
Funny?
I mean, some of the stories, you know, like, they're not as bad as they used to be. Remember, there used to be the ones about, like, you know, like, I ate a live cat. And,
oh, yeah.
And those kinds
you
of
don't
things.
See, the Humane Association got involved with that.
Yes.
Cleared all that up. Then there was the Carol Burnett lawsuit.
Right.
Did that help at all? I mean, did that...
I've never been written much about in these tabloids. So, either I don't sell tabloids, because I'm sure if I did, they would write about me.
Uh-huh.
So I've not had that problem. I mean, very, very once in a, you know, very infrequently has there been, like, some little item. Like, I remember one time in one of the columns, it said, Lily Tomlin and Frank Sinatra don't pay for their booze. it was something about, like, some liquor store in L.A. or something that we both had credit in our accounts with. Somehow, inadvertently, one of us or both of us had failed to pay our bill on time. And so it's so silly kind of to read something like this. You know, I mean, the way they tell it, it's like, I mean, so there is a grain of truth to it. Apparently I did not pay some particular bill or didn't pay it for a long time. But then to see myself sort of linked with Sinatra in a liquor store, you know, it's sort of absurd.
Well, what if they would write something awful about you? I mean,
I wouldn't like it.
Well, of course you wouldn't like it. I mean, would it really hurt your feelings? Would you cry, or would you get mad, or would you sue?
Oh, I might
cry.
I might cry. I've cried. I've cried not just from tabloids.
Oh, come on, you don't cry. I mean, you go out on stages like this, and you entertain millions of people.
Teddy, it's come as a shock, but I do cry.
You cry?
Uh-huh.
When?
I cry, let me think. Well, I've cried. I cried if it's particularly brutal, you know. I think it's probably, I mean, I don't know psychologically what the steps are, but I bet it's some kind of human evolution of experience. Like, it's like death, you know, having a terminal illness. And you go through certain stages of first, you know, absolute anger, and then you go through a stage of denial, and you go through a stage of self-pity, and then you go through a stage of acceptance. And so I'm sure any kind of deep hurt, you know, I'm not comparing something in the press to having a terminal illness, but on some lesser scale, less intense scale, you probably have certain similar stages you go through. You know, first you read it and you're just furious and terribly angry, you know, and then maybe you read it and you try to get corroboration from other people that it's not true, you know, and so in a way you want to deny it, and then you probably just go through a terrible period where you just feel terribly sorry for yourself, you know, that you've been picked on or that they're saying something horrible about you.
And then when all else is gone.
And then finally you've been purged and you accept it, you know, and then you go on talk shows and you tell how you've grown.
Or you divorce somebody.
And it's not untrue. It's not untrue. I mean, it's a cliche right now, but it's a common it's a common experience, and certainly common for people in the business.
Yeah.
There's very few people who haven't had very big highs and very big lows.
But for people who make jokes and do funny things, it could come as a surprise. Let me take a break,
okay.
And we'll talk more, okay?
Of course.
Lily Tomlin's here. We'll be right back. And when they tell about how they got started, they really had tough times. The information that I read about you, you had a little tough going, but it really wasn't a long history of struggling, was it?
No, I don't remember it like that. No, I don't. That it was long. No, I remember it as being relatively, you know, smooth.
Yeah, you did a few things in the business.
Yeah.
In the entertainment business. Then you were at Howard Johnson's for a while.
Yeah, I was at many, many places. Howard Johnson's, lots of coffee shops, lots of office temps, you know.
Yeah.
Lots of envelope typing. But what came to my mind when you just said that was... I don't think there were two factors probably. One, I started late. You know, I didn't go to New York when I was 17 or anything, so that You'd have this incredible period of struggle, maybe, you know, but because a person doing comedy, they're not anywhere able to do comedy until they're a little more mature.
I had heard that. You have to have a little bit.
Well, I mean, I would think that, you know, you said you'd have some kind of point of view, and you might be able to invent things, but you would just be kind of a kid struggling along. I can't imagine a 17-year-old doing comedy of any real consequence. I mean, as a comic actor,
well,
they might be great.
If a comedian represents life, he doesn't know a lot about life.
Yeah, that's the point. So I didn't go to New York even until I was 24. So already I saved myself 7 years of struggle in New York, see. And then, and by the time I got there, first of all, I didn't care about being famous. I wanted to work as an actor and to create material and things like that. And that was going to be plenty for me. I thought that was a great life, to be a New York actor and have community with other actors and do good roles and have the respect and admiration of your peers, you know, and continuously work at your craft.
With no thought of success.
Well, success is earning a living. I wanted to earn a living, yes. But being famous, I felt, was pretty much a liability. You know, had its drawbacks.
And does it?
A little. But how can I really evaluate it now? Because I am famous. And so it's difficult for me. It's hard for me to even, like, throw myself back to the time before. And I also used to say, well, once you get famous, you can't be not famous anymore.
Well, wait a minute.
You can slip out of favor, but that doesn't mean you're not famous. People still, in fact, that's a horrible part of being famous. The speech that Mickey Rooney made on the Oscars, you know, was very moving.
Brilliant.
And I thought there was no bitterness in it. It was really quite, it was very touching and honest, you know. I mean, it wasn't sappy besides. I mean, it was like, I'm sure he went through tremendous pain and struggle over that. Here, a kid 19, 20 years old, the number one box office star in the world, and as he said, 20 years later, I couldn't get a job. Or maybe it wasn't even 20 years later. And you become laughable, you know, in many ways. I mean, it's like, this does happen to celebrities. Even someone as classic and great as Hepburn, you probably could name half a dozen others if you really went back and researched it. I mean, there was many times she's referred in print to the fact that theater owners, you know, named her box office poison in such and such a year, maybe like 1945. Years. I'm making this up, but
the fame was, I see what you mean. The fame was still there, but
this terrible disfavor, you know, this, or you have a series of failures or something, and it's in the business is so mercurial. It's astonishing, you know, when you see one person, particularly now, it seems absolutely anything goes. You can just flop back and forth. There was a time when certain parameters were laid down for a certain kind of career, you know, and as long as you sort of observed them and you had real artistry and you know, and people didn't make crossovers, you know, people didn't come from Vegas and do this, or people didn't come from another place, and they do. It's quite incredible. And 1 year, a person who nobody would think of as doing a certain kind of work, the next year they totally surprise you, and they might win an Oscar.
When Laugh-In happened for you, was it overwhelming for you, or did you say, well, this is nice, this goes along with what I want?
I quite enjoyed it. You know, at first I was scared. I mean, not scared, but I was like, I was uncomfortable for a short period of time because it was just so fast because of Ernestine. And I went to New York over Christmas hiatus because I still had an apartment in New York because I didn't think I was going to make it in California. I just went and got on television, and then I got on Laugh-In, and then I did Ernestine, and here I was overnight. I was like a huge success in terms of television, and people all just went crazy for this character, you know, and I'd see people the first few days after it aired, and they'd say, oh, you're that new star, aren't you, on Laugh-In? I'd say, oh, no, you know, it was just like, I mean, plus it was awkward. It was strange, you know, for people to say that. It just didn't have any reality. And then I'd see people would be crestfallen, you know, and then so I began to enjoy it, and I saw they wanted it to be you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they were quite affectionate in the exchange.
And they don't want you to deny what they want you to be. or what
yeah,
they see?
Yeah, kind of. So I came around to, I've had, I would say 98% very, you know, positive experiences with people in the streets. And then once in a while, somebody taps you on the shoulder, you know, and says, Lily, give me a kiss. You know, and I said, I usually say, well, now I can't go around kissing everybody, you know, that doesn't make sense, you know. And he says, come on, give me a kiss, just right here even. And then I say, well, how come, you know? And, because why should I give away these precious things so cavalierly?
Absolutely.
And he says, well, every time you come on TV, my wife says, oh, I can't stand her. So when I go home, I want to tell her you kissed me. I said, well, buzz off. I wasn't quite that polite.
Okay, we'll be back with some more kind words from Lily Tomlin right after this. A minute left.
We do?
Mm-hmm.
What do you want to do with it?
Well, you want to finish chewing on ice?
Okay.
Got
it's
it done?
Gone.
Oh. What's next? You're in. We're taping this in Nashville, where you are performing and appearing nightly to sold out audiences, and you're taking the show all over the country.
A few places. I don't just go. I just don't tour nonstop. What happens is if I'm working on a script and it's not coming well, you know, just kind of it's bogged down, then I'll say to the people who work with me, you know, I'll say, well, let's go on the road for a couple of months. And I'll work on some new stuff, and it's good to get back out into on the stage, because I like the stage best of all anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And I toured this show very little, so there's lots of places I haven't gone, you know. So then I call around and I get some places to play that I like, then I do it. I work on new stuff.
This is hard to answer, I know, but to have millions of people applauding for you and cheering for you and giving so much to you of their appreciation, how do you feel about it in 30 seconds or less? Is it a tremendous ego trip, quite honestly, or do you feel like, gee, they're nice to do that? Or
well, you really only you experience it mostly on the stage, you know, in a theater, theater with a live exchange. And I, because I love to perform on the stage, and I get tremendous, it's a different line looking out here at the stage, you know, because there's something magical when it's great, you know. It's just, first of all, I want to give a lot in my performance myself, you know, and so when I get a lot back, I get very turned on and exhilarated.
That's the bottom line. That turn, Joan. We're out of time.
Okay.
Thanks for talking to me.
In fact, you know, if you've ever seen an actor...